want you to come, Holy Spirit. Oh, come, Holy Spirit, come and abide within us. Rest upon us. Come, Holy Spirit, come, 'cause we need your presence. We need you. Oh, we need your presence. Spirit, we need you. We need you. We need you. We need your presence. We need you. Come, Holy Spirit.
The glory, and we've
come to bless your name. Oh Lord, we adore you. Lord, we give you the highest praise. It's hallelujah, thine the glory. Come to bless your name. Oh, we come to worship.
We come to worship.
We come to praise.
We come to praise.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
We come to worship.
We come to worship.
We come to pray.
We come to praise.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to magnify.
We come to magnify.
We come to pray.
We come to pray.
We come to magnify.
We come to magnify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to magnify.
We come to magnify.
We come to pray.
We come to pray.
We come to magnify.
We come to magnify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
We come to pray.
We come to pray.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
Oh, we come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
God, we come to praise.
We come to praise.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to lift you.
We come to lift you up.
We come to praise.
We come to praise.
We come to lift you up.
We come to lift you up.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
Hey, we come to lift.
We come to lift you up.
God, we came to praise.
We come to praise.
We come to lift you up.
We come to lift
and
you
bless
up.
Your name.
Bless your
say it
name.
Again. And we come to lift you up.
We come to lift you up.
We came to pray.
We come to pray.
We come to lift you up.
We come to lift
and
you
bless
up.
Bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to live.
We come to lift you up.
We came to pray.
We come to pray.
We come to lift you up.
We come to lift
and
you
and bless
up.
Your name.
And bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
Oh,
we bless your name.
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 One more time, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
God, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
Bless your name.
We bless your name.
We come to worship.
We come to worship.
We came to pray.
We come to praise.
Came to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to worship.
We come to worship.
We came to pray.
We come to praise.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your
one more time.
Name.
We come to worship.
We come to worship.
We come to pray.
We come to praise.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to worship.
We come to worship.
We came to pray.
We come to praise.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
Bless your name.
And bless your name.
Say it one more time. We came to worship.
We come to worship.
What about you? We came to pray.
We come to praise.
Came to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless his name.
And bless your name.
Oh, we come to worship.
We come to worship.
God, we came to pray.
We come to pray.
We come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
And bless your name.
And bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name. We bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
Oh, your holy name.
We bless your name.
We bless your holy name.
We bless your name.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. God, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
God, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
Your saving name.
We bless your name.
God, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
Bless your healing name.
We bless your name.
Bless your healing name.
We bless your name.
Oh, bless
your name.
God, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
Oh, we bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
We bless your name.
Yeah, yeah.
Bless your name.
God, bless your name.
We bless your name.
Oh, your name.
We bless your name.
Cause we came to worship.
We come to worship.
Come to pray.
We come to pray.
Ooh, Jesus, come to glorify.
We come to glorify.
Bless your name.
And bless your name.
Nothing else matters. We came to worship.
We come to worship.
God, we came to praise.
We come to pray.
Oh, came to glorify.
We come to glorify.
Bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh.
We come to worship. We come to worship, God. We bless your name. We come to worship.
Bless you, bless you.
We come to praise.
Oh, yeah.
We come to glorify.
Oh, yeah.
And bless your name.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
I came to worship.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And I came to praise.
Oh, yeah.
I came to glorify. I bless your name.
Oh, yeah,
help me
yeah.
say, I came to worship.
Yeah.
I came to praise. I came to glorify.
I bless
your name. I came to worship.
I came to worship.
I came to praise.
I came to praise.
I came to glorify.
I came to glorify.
I bless your name.
And bless your name.
Oh, I came to worship.
I came to worship.
I came to praise.
I came to praise.
I came to glorify.
I came to glorify.
I bless your name.
And bless your name.
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
Oh, I bless your name. I bless your name.
I bless your name.
Have your way, God.
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
Oh,
I bless your name.
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 Oh,
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
I bless your name.
I came to worship.
I came to worship.
I came to praise.
I came to praise.
I came to glorify.
I came to glorify.
And bless your name.
I came to worship.
I came to worship.
I came to praise.
I came to praise.
Oh, yeah.
I came to glorify. And bless your name.
Hallelujah. Come on and bless him. Yeah. Hallelujah. Come on and bless him. This is the reason why we're here. Hallelujah. No other reason but to bless the name of the Lord. In spite of, we come to worship. We come to praise you, oh God. We come to honor you and to bless your name.
Yes, God.
The word of the Lord says, order my steps in your word, and let not any iniquity have dominion over me. Plead my cause, oh Lord, and deliver me. Quicken me according to thy word. Lord, give me understanding according to thy word. Let my soul live and it shall praise thee.
Yes, yes.
Let thy judgments forever help me.
Yes.
Father God, we love you this morning. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh upon us today. We come before you, God. We stand together as one. Father God, beneath your mercies and beneath your grace, we come to your throne, God, that we may obtain help and favor in the time of need. Holy Ghost, as we present ourselves before you, we ask that you empower us, enable us to render the due worship and the due praise unto our Father. Lord Jesus, we lift you up. Be thou exalted above the heavens. And God, we promise to give you all the glory and all the honor. We love you, sir. Have your way in and through us in Jesus' name. Somebody shout amen.
Oh, come on and give him praise in the house. Come on and give him praise in the house. He is Lord. Come on, come on. Oh, stand to your feet in this house. Come on. Come on, stand to your feet in this house. Standing is a form of praise. Come on, stand. If you got two legs that work, stand. A form of praise, yes. We came to say that he is Lord.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
on, clap those hands. Come on. Yeah. Look at our dancers. They look good. Yeah. Woo. Oh, come on. I am the first. Come on.
I am the first and the last.
Great I am.
I am the great I am.
Just trust in me.
Just trust in me.
Supply.
To supply all your needs.
Do you believe?
Do you believe?
Savior mighty God.
Savior mighty God.
Prince of peace.
Prince of peace.
Ruler.
Ruler, source of everything.
Worthy of glory.
Worthy of glory and majesty.
Oh, clap those hands. Come on, say it loud. He is the Lord.
He is Lord. Woo.
Jesus is.
Jesus is Lord.
Son of David.
The Son of David to reign for eternity.
He is.
He is Lord.
Jesus is.
Jesus is Lord.
Yeah. All glory and honor.
All glory and honor belong to the King of Kings.
I'll praise him. Come on, praise him. First,
I am the first and the last.
I'm the great I am.
I am the great I am.
Just trust in me.
Just trust in me to supply all your needs.
Do you believe?
Do you believe?
Savior mighty God.
Savior mighty God. Prince of peace.
Ruler and source.
Ruler, source of everything.
Worthy of glory.
Worthy of glory.
Everybody say
he is Lord.
Jesus is.
Jesus is Lord.
He's the Son of David. Come on.
The Son of David to reign for eternity.
One more time.
He is Lord.
Everybody say Jesus is.
Jesus is Lord.
All glory and honor, come on.
All glory and honor belong to the King of Kings.
He is Lord.
He is Lord.
Hey. Jesus is
Lord.
Son of David.
The Son of David to reign for eternity. Lord,
all glory and honor, come on.
All glory and honor belongs to the King of Kings.
Lord, we worship and adore you. You are worthy. We love you.
We love.
We love.
We love.
We love.
We love.
Shoot a big breath. We say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Keep us smiling, Lord. We say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we wave
hallelujah.
Our hands. Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Lord, you made a way
hallelujah.
When there was no
hallelujah.
Way. So we lift our
hallelujah.
Hands and we give you praise.
Hallelujah.
We say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We say hallelujah.
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 Highest praise. Come on, give it to him. 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 Give it to him.
Hallelujah. Your honor, heaven, worship in your spirit. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
We love you, God. We love you. We love you. We love you, God. We
hallelujah.
Love you. We love you, God. We
thank
love you, God.
You
we
Lord.
Love you because you're a wonderful
you
God.
Hallelujah.
You are a wonderful
thank
God.
You,
God. You are a wonderful God.
Thank
you are a wonderful God. You are a wonderful God.
Yes, you are.
You are a wonderful
yes,
God.
You are. Yes, you are.
You are a wonderful
yes, you
God.
Are.
You are a wonderful
yes,
God.
God.
You are a wonderful God.
Hallelujah.
You are a wonderful God. You are a wonderful God.
Yes, God.
You are a wonderful God.
Hallelujah.
You are
hallelujah.
A wonderful God.
Hallelujah.
You are a wonderful
hallelujah.
God. You are a wonderful God. You are a wonderful God. Yes. 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 You are wonderful God. Yes. You are a wonderful God. Yes.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Oh Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh Lord, he's a wonderful God.
Oh Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
I'm singing, oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Singing, oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Oh, I'm crying, oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God. Yes, you are.
Oh, yes, yeah. He's a wonderful God.
Singing, oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Then we give you the glory. God, we give you the praise. Our hearts are filled with gladness. And we worship your name.
Lord, we worship
and praise.
And praise your name.
Glorify. Magnify your name. Singing, oh Lord, you're a wonderful God. Yeah.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Singing, oh Lord, wonderful God you are. Yes, you are.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Crying, oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes,
yes, you are,
a
God.
Wonderful God.
Singing, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
God, we give you the glory. And we give you the praise. Our hearts are filled with gladness as we lift up your name.
Oh, we worship
and we praise
and praise your name.
We glorify and we magnify your name. Oh, Lord, you're wonderful. Yes, you are. Lord, you're wonderful. Yes, you are. Lord, you are wonderful. Yes, you are. Lord, you are wonderful. Yes, you are. Come on and say it.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yeah.
Yes, you are.
Say it, Lord.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, you are.
You're wonderful.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you're wonderful.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Say it again, Lord.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
How many know it?
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Say, Lord.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
How many know it?
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Say it again, Lord.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Oh, come on. Tap your hands.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Sing it, hey, Lord.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you are wonderful.
Lord, you're wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Hey, you're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
You are holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
God is holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
You're holy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
worthy.
You're worthy.
You are worthy.
You're worthy.
You're so worthy.
You're worthy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
You are worthy.
You're worthy.
God, you are worthy.
You're worthy.
God, I know you're worthy.
You're worthy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you are worthy.
You're worthy.
Of all of my praise.
You're worthy.
God, you're worthy.
You're worthy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you are worthy.
You're worthy.
You are so worthy.
You're worthy.
You are so worthy.
You're worthy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
You are so worthy.
You're worthy.
God, you are worthy.
You're worthy.
I know that you're worthy.
You're worthy.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Say wonderful.
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 You're wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are. Wonderful.
You're wonderful.
Wonderful.
You are wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
How many know he's wonderful?
Wonderful.
He's a wonderful.
Wonderful.
God is a wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
My God is a wonderful.
Wonderful.
He's a wonderful.
Wonderful.
He is a wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you are wonderful.
Wonderful.
You're wonderful to me, God.
Wonderful.
You are wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Ain't nobody like you.
Wonderful.
Ain't nobody like you.
Wonderful.
Ain't nobody like you.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
You are my healer.
Wonderful.
And you're wonderful.
Wonderful.
My deliverer.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you are my savior.
Wonderful.
My deliverer.
Wonderful.
You're my savior.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
He's my savior.
Wonderful.
My savior.
Wonderful.
He's my savior.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Everything I need, God.
Wonderful.
Everything I need, God.
Wonderful.
Everything I need, God.
Wonderful.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
God, you are wonderful.
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 Yes, you are.
Yes, you are.
Oh, Lord, you are wonderful, God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Oh, Lord, you're wonderful, God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Say it again. Oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, wonderful you are.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Oh, Lord, you're a wonderful, wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
I gotta say it again, oh, Lord. You're a wonderful God.
Yeah. Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Oh, Lord, you're a wonderful God.
Oh, yes, he's a wonderful God.
Yeah. Wonderful. 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 Oh, yes. He's wonderful. Oh, yes. He's wonderful. Y'all ain't ready. Y'all ain't ready. I dare you to tap three people and say, may the rest of your year be wonderful. May the rest of your year be wonderful because he's wonderful. Come on, I dare you to tap somebody. May the rest of your year be wonderful because he's wonderful. May the rest of your year be wonderful because he's wonderful. May the rest of your year be wonderful because he's wonderful. Hey! right there. You just helped somebody right there.
Ooh, yeah.
You just helped somebody right there. Third month of the new year. The third month of the new year. And we already declaring that the rest of your year is going to be wonderful. That the next 9 months going to blow your mind. It's going to be wonderful because he's wonderful. He's holy. He's worthy. He's wonderful. Y'all go ahead and be seated. Y'all going to catch that thing in a minute. When you go home and turn on your lights, I dare you to yell out wonderful. When you get in your car, when you leave here, I dare you to get in your car and just say wonderful.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Oh, bless you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
When you open up your refrigerator, just say wonderful.
Hallelujah.
Yes, I don't know about you, but I can testify there have been a time when I opened my refrigerator, there was nothing in there.
Hallelujah.
Thank God for his word. He shall, I will supply all your needs.
Yes, Lord.
I don't know about you, but I just got to say wonderful Jesus.
That's what he is.
He is wonderful.
He is.
He is wonderful.
He is.
And if you don't believe it, just look at me. He is wonderful.
He is. Yes, he is.
Look
yes,
at the person next to you. He is wonderful.
He is.
You don't know their testimony. He's wonderful. Hallelujah. Any first-time visitors here, would you just wave your hand? Any first-time visitors, just wave your hands. We all brothers and sisters. The family is here. Come on, give it up for your brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Oh, come on, give it up for your brothers and your sisters of the Potter's house. I dare you to stand up on your feet and show some real love for them. Come on, look at him. Say, I'm so glad to see you. I'm so glad to see you. I'm so glad to see you. I love you. Yeah, I'm so glad to see you. Hallelujah. Y'all sit down. We just don't love on our visitors, but we love on each other. So we don't have no visitors. Y'all praise God for each other. Well, we glad you made it here to the Potter's House Dayton International Ministries, where y'all know our Pura, our spiritual father is none other than the Bishop Mark C. McGuire. Hallelujah. Come on, now everybody stand up for God. Everybody stand up for God and give God praise for our bishop. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for our bishop. Thank you, God. I don't know about you, but I just feel a shout in my spirit. I don't know what it is, but I just really feel a shout in my spirit, Doc Bam. I just don't know what it is. I just feel a shout in my spirit. Wonderful.
Yes, he is.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Wonderful.
God
is. Wonderful.
My God is. My God is. Isaiah 43:21 says,
this people have I formed for myself, and they shall show forth my praise. Somebody praise a wonderful God. Somebody give glory to the wonderful God.
Hallelujah.
I just felt that in my spirit. There got to be a breakthrough for somebody. And I don't know. I just shouted for you, so I don't know if that's you. You've been seeking God. You've been waiting on something from God. I don't know, but I just shouted for you. Your breakthrough is on the way. Your deliverance is on the way. Your salvation is on the way. Your miracle is on the way. Your healing is on the way.
Back in the day, you say, if I couldn't say a word.
All right now, all right.
I just wave my hand.
All right. Hallelujah. Whoa. Hallelujah.
I'm trying to move on. At the end of service, we take our offering. Don't nobody leave before the benediction. If you're sowing a seed, sow your seed and go back by faith, knowing you shall reap what you just sown. Hey!
Jesus is real. I can feel him.
I had a praise and I had to get it out. God, you've been so good to us. God, you've been so good to us. And we thank you. God, we stand in need of you right now. We need you, oh God. God, but we thank you. We thank you. We're desperate for you even right now, oh God. This first Sunday of the third month of this year, we need you, oh God. And we're desperate for you. Here we are, standing, kneeling, crying out before you, a wonderful God, an excellent God, a worthy God, a holy God. Thank you. Father, we lift up our bishop to you right now. Speak to him even right now, oh God. Rest, rule, and abide in this place, oh God. Save, set free, and deliver in this place today, oh God. We thank you for this communion Sunday where we remember the blood shed for us, the body broken and beaten just for us. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you. Thank you. Father, we honor you. We bless you. This atmosphere is conducive for you, God. And for only you, no flesh be glorified, but you, the Spirit of the living God, be magnified and exalted on high. God, we thank you. Hear our cry. Hear our cries as we lift our hands to you in worship. As we lift our hearts to you in worship, hear our cry, O God. We'll bless you forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever, forever and ever and ever and evermore. We count it done in the name of Jesus. Every heart said amen. Come on, lift your hands to him. Lift your hands to him. Open up your mouth and just let God hear your voice. Let him hear your heart. Come on, everybody standing. Come on, lift your hands to him. Don't sit down on God. He's here. Come on, lift your hands and just tell him thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, God.
Of prayer, oh, here. standing in the need of prayer.
Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us. Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us. You heard us. You heard us.
Thank you. Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us. Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us. You heard us. You heard us.
Thank you. Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
Oh, say it with it. Come on, say it.
Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
Thank you.
Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
You heard us.
You heard us.
You heard.
You heard us.
Thank you. Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us. Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
Thank you.
Thank you for hearing our prayer. You heard us.
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 God, you heard us.
You heard us.
God, you heard us.
You heard us.
I despair and cry.
You heard us.
Oh, you heard us.
You heard us.
I'm glad you heard us.
You heard us.
God, you heard us.
You heard us.
God, you heard us.
You heard us.
God, you heard us.
You heard us.
Aren't you glad that he heard you?
You heard us.
Aren't you glad that he heard you?
You heard
us. Aren't you glad that he heard you?
You heard us.
Aren't you glad his answer was a no?
You heard us.
Aren't you glad that he heard you?
You heard us.
God, you heard us.
You heard us.
You heard us.
You heard us.
And you heard us.
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 God, you heard my cry.
You heard us.
God, you heard my cry.
You heard us.
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 Here I am.
Here I am.
Standing.
Standing in the need of prayer.
Oh.
Oh, here I am. Standing in the need of prayer. Oh, here I am.
It's me, O Lord.
Standing in the need of prayer. Oh, here I am.
Standing.
Standing in the need of prayer.
Anybody out there need him right now?
Are you standing in the need?
Say, Lord, I have need of thee.
Lord, I have need of thee. I have need, I need, I need, I need, I need, I need thee every hour. need thee every hour, God. Was shed for me. Here I am.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Another moment without the presence of God.
Standing in the need of
God, I need you. God, I won't make it without you. Sure, they needed food. Sure, they needed clothing. Sure, they needed shelter. But this was a need for his presence. This was a need to just know that he had not forgotten about them, that the covenant and the promises that he made, it was still real. I'm going to believe that there's somebody in here today that just needs to know that the promises are still real. In the midst of everything, here I am. But not just prayer so God would bless you, but they also said, God, here I am. I want to do your will. I want to be right with you. I want our relationship to be solid. And so this prayer was, help me serve you. Help me love you. Help me obey your commandments. Without God's help, it's impossible to obey him. He doesn't love us because we obey him. He loves us to help him, help us obey him. Come on, one more time. You sing it with him. Here I am. Standing. Come on.
Standing in the need of prayer. Oh,
you have covenant with God, give God some praise. Because the Bible says if he hears us, then we shall receive the petitions that we ask for. He's an awesome God. He's an awesome God. Hallelujah. Somebody just help me shout hallelujah. We are thankful. We are thankful. First Sunday of March, we are very thankful. We will be back here tonight at 6 p.m. for communion. So we look forward to all those that will make their way back for communion this evening. We got some of the normal stuff going on that takes place Tuesdays and Thursdays and Monday, and we kind of know that routine, Young Life and Zumba and hula hoop, amen. So we kind of know that. We know that our trainings, first and third, and our specific classes, second and fourth, marriage and singles ministry. So we want you to continue to be here at 9 a.m. to enjoy those and to be empowered. Amen. I want to stress that to many of you that I really want to see more of the single women in the single women's empowerment session, the married couples, even if one of the spouses has to work, not available in those classes as well. I want to begin to see mothers bring their 16, 17, and 18-year-old daughters to the single women's class. Amen. And so we want to be empowered as we go through this next season of greater grace. Amen. God's doing something special, and we want to be a part of that. On Friday nights, we have specific trainings each Friday of the month. Kingdom Economics on the first Friday. This Friday, we will enjoy spiritual warfare. Amen. And then the third Friday is Principles of Bible Study. The fourth Friday is Spiritual Gifts. And then on the fifth Friday of any month, unless in March we've got the Easter month, we're going to do that a little early this month. It'll be the fourth Friday. We're going to have a Jubilee Friday where it's just going to be some praise and worship and just believing God to do some great things in our lives. Amen. But I really want to stress, everybody say empowerment and training. I really want to stress that, because what we as a pastor and the elders are here to do is to help lead this body of local believers according to the vision that God has given us. We're also here to help you individually as you need it, but we can't spend one-on-one time with everybody, especially if you're not taking advantage of the things that's already done corporately. Amen? And so we've got to take responsibility of that. So those things that are there, when we talk about money management, we're talking about investing, you're talking about doing things that God would want you to do, not going through that same cycle. We're here on Fridays to talk about what's God's way and how does God expect us to steward what belongs to him. Amen. And so the same thing with the empowerment classes, with marriages, with being a single man or a single woman. We want to take advantage of those things. And so I'm thankful for that. All right. We want to continue to get ready for our trip to Jacksonville. And to be honest, before we know it, we go every year, for those that don't know it, and celebrate the pastoral and wedding anniversary of my spiritual father, my bishop, Bishop Vaughn Monroe McLaughlin. Amen. And so we want to, all those that can go and those that can't, we send gifts. We send seed, we put it in envelopes, we do what we got to do, we put it in somebody's hand to be a blessing to him and his wife, phenomenal general and first lady of the kingdom, amen, phenomenal spiritual parents, but also just spiritual models of the goodness of God, and so we're thankful for that. Continue to pray for those that had to deal with any type of tragedy or loss this week, still stunned and just want to lift up the entire, not just personal family, but church family, the Dayton family, kingdom family, for the loss of our friend William Schuller. Amen. He was a tremendous individual, and it's always so funny how when something happens to someone, somebody always has something negative to say. Amen. I'm always amazed at the negativity, especially of the saints. You know, it's just amazing that we love to have something negative to say about somebody. Well, I can just say this for anyone that knew him or doesn't know him or never embarked upon him. In 1999, there were three people that said something to me in the midst of my depression that gave me the wherewithal to keep doing what God had called me to do. And William Schuller was one of them. So if you've ever been blessed by this ministry, you ought to stand to your feet and salute somebody who's spoken to the life of somebody that has helped you. And I'll be forever indebted to anyone that is a part of his family that needs me. Because when I needed somebody, he spoke into my life. And I could really care less about what somebody else thinks about. Amen. He was a blessing to this city. He opened up great doors for many of us who are under 50. I'm barely under 50, but who are under 50 and are preaching the gospel and doing anything in this city. People listen to what he had to say. So we're just continuing to just lift up his family. So, and all of you all that are dealing with folks in the hospital and things like that, I got a few calls while I was gone and situations going on. We are lifting those up in prayer, and we're believing God for something great for them. Amen. Also, I want to mention that on this Friday, on March 11th, Tommy McGuffey and True Worship is having their CD release at Christ Cathedral, and we are one of the sponsors for his event, and on Wednesday night, we're going to be giving away tickets to that concert. And so if you're here on Wednesday, you may be able to receive some tickets for that concert. And I am not going to have Bible study Friday. I promised that we would support him and that I would support him personally. So I have to be there, keep my word. So I will be there Friday night with him. So this Friday, we will not have Bible study. So if you're interested in going and don't want to purchase a ticket, then you may want to show up Wednesday when we start giving them away. Amen. Because if I got some left over, I'm going to walk up and down Germantown and down to the baths and far as I can go to see if anybody wants to go hear some gospel music. Amen. And so we are thankful for him and his ministry. And sometimes when you got folks in your own ministry like Elder Craig and Minister Pam and other folk who are looking forward to doing CDs and things of that nature, you got to sow before you can reap. Amen. You got to sow into another man's work before God will bless you with yours. And so I'm excited about that. Amen. I hope God moves y'all. Y'all look like y'all dead to the water last night. Like Medea came last night or something. Y'all all stayed out with Medea last night. Lord have mercy. Y'all just laid back, chilling, just relaxing. Lord have mercy. I'm almost scared of this group this morning. Okay. Hallelujah. Also, we want to also pray for my good friend, like a brother to me, Charles Miller. His father transitioned, and his services were last week as well. And so we want to lift that up. I know he watches sometimes. So, Chuck, we love you. And we just remember that. Also, we have the men's conference is coming up. And, man, I am thoroughly excited. And I'm challenging every man of this fellowship to bring someone, and every female of this fellowship, if some men that are significant in your life don't normally attend church or normally attend here, I'm challenging you to bring them. Three dynamic men of God will be here during that week and just absolutely blessing us. They are so excited about it. Pastor Apostle Arthur McGuire will be here on Wednesday night. Pastor Robert Brown will be here on Thursday night. Bishop Vaughn McLaughlin will be here on Friday night. And then we are excited. We're excited. There'll also be a special ministers meeting early Saturday morning and then a church meeting. Look at your neighbor and say, church meeting. No, you're not getting ready to vote on nothing. But we'll have a special church meeting for all that want to come out, where Bishop's going to impart into us just talking about the move of God and what's happening in the earth and how the church needs to be mobile in it. Amen. And how every member plays a part, every son and daughter plays a part. And so those that are available for that, we want you to come out for that as well. So we'll get you more information. I know we've got a couple of birthdays that have passed. I know Sister Val, she had a birthday, and we had some other birthdays that have gone forth in the month of March. And then I know on tomorrow, it's my son's birthday, Mark Jr. Amen. So now that he's over 25 and got a job, I only had to give him like $20 now for his birthday and a little card that's more precious than the money. What a blessing. What a blessing. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. A few more years with my other one with the big bucks on the birthday, but we're going to hook him up. We're going to hook him up. Amen. So we're thankful for him. And he's born the same day as one of my best friends ever. And also our minister of dance, Selena Spears. Amen. All their birthdays are tomorrow. And so we are thankful for them. All right. So I think that's all my announcements. I think we better hurry up and sing, dance, pray, preach or something. And see God move. Don't want to forget, on March the 15th, the Kingdom Builder will have our first session up in the McLaughlin Hall. So those that are looking at just every aspect of building your life, moving toward housing, moving toward good credit, moving toward financial empowerment, everything that you can get in the natural will be provided through some of these sessions. And I'm looking forward to that. That is this next Tuesday at 6 p.m. March the 15th. And so those that are in Thai class, we've got a couple more sessions to finish. We'll probably do, depending on the numbers, we'll either be down or up. So we'll make that adjustment. So the room will be to be announced, but we will be here on the 15th, which is a Tuesday. All right, Kingdom Building Solutions. I think that's all my announcements. I don't know if there's anything else that I need to say. Shalonda Vaughn's birthday is tomorrow. How did I forget Shalonda Vaughn? I am so sorry. Shalonda Vaughn, I knew that. March the 7th. I don't know. I get everybody mixed up. I thought Val's was today. I just jacked that up. So, Shalonda, we love you, and we thank God for you keeping our place pretty and hooked up. And so we thank God for you. And anybody else? Before I forget and get shot from the back. Anybody? That's it. Terry, it ain't your birthday? Well, praise the Lord. All right. So we're thankful for that. All right. I believe that God's going to speak to us in a special way. It's the season for it. God somehow works things out to where right when we need it, he was already getting ready to say it. So we are thankful for that. All right. So won't you just hug a couple people, tell them that you love them, shake somebody, wake them up. And tell them that I'm glad that you're just one word away. All right? Keep playing. Mention to everyone, we know that Resurrection Sunday is in March this year, and so on March the 27th, we will be here expecting God to move in a great way through our praise and worship ministry, dance ministry, the worship and arts ministry in general, and some of you will be a part of that production. You paid it all, speaking to our thanksgiving to God for what he has done. So I'm excited about that. I love Resurrection Sunday. I love specifically celebrating, even though we celebrate his death, burial, and resurrection every day, I specifically love the day that we have carved out to give special notice for that. So again, please invite all that you know. If they have their own worship facility or place of worship, we want to encourage them to go there, but if not, invite them. Amen. And when you invite people, try to invite people that don't have a house of worship. Don't try to get people to come, you know, spend time at your church and they have a church. You know, encourage them to go to their church and be blessed by their pastor and the people that they love. But the folks that don't have church, you know, we want to try to encourage them. Amen. And so we are thankful. So if everyone could just stand for a moment. I am going to read the scriptures, and then they are going to bless us. I'm going to ask if you got two good legs, not holding a baby, that you would stand. Micah chapter 6, verse 8. We'll attempt to finish this, what the Lord has started, but he is so, so timely. And then Luke chapter 10, verses 36 and 37. I'm on task. I'm staying where God has me. I didn't come back to say something because I heard something from down in Jacksonville, but I will say that this is one of those times in going to Jacksonville that I didn't get what I wanted. I got what I needed. And it was a wonderful, wonderful time, especially the impartation from the brothers and sisters. That was probably the most refreshing of this week, is being refreshed by the brothers and sisters as well as the Father. Amen. And recognizing that there's greatness in more than just him. And what has been pouring out of him has found residence in the lives of some people that love him and love God. And so it was a blessing, both the men and the women. And we're trying to figure out a way how to share that publicly and corporately. There may be days where I will just announce we'll be showing one of the Covenant Fellowship meetings, and we'll just play it in the sanctuary. You will be extraordinarily blessed. Every day, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, and 7 p.m. was absolutely amazing. Every day. Micah says, he has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? Luke 10, 36 and 37 simply says, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. Today I'll be ministering from the subject, compassionate ministry on purpose. Compassionate ministry on purpose.
There's been a change changed me, yeah.
Suddenly.
Said he did it.
And he did it.
Did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
And he did it.
And he did it.
My God did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
Changed the way I want.
And he did it.
He did it suddenly, yeah.
Suddenly.
Said he did it.
And he did it.
God did it, yes it is.
Suddenly.
God did it, yeah.
And he did it.
Did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
And he did it.
And he did it.
Suddenly, yeah.
Suddenly.
He did it.
And he did it.
Did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
My God did it.
And he did it.
Did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
My God changed me.
He did it.
He did it suddenly, yeah.
Suddenly.
Oh, he did it, yeah.
And he did it.
Did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
Oh, yeah. And
he did it.
Suddenly, yeah.
Suddenly.
He did it, yeah.
And he did it.
Did he do it for you, yeah?
Suddenly.
Did it change
and
you?
He did it.
Got the victory, yeah, yeah.
Suddenly.
Got the victory, oh yeah.
He did
I got
it.
The victory, yes I do.
Suddenly.
I got the victory, yes
and
I do. My God did it, yes it is.
Suddenly.
And he did it.
And he did it.
He did it, yeah.
Suddenly.
My God did it.
And he did it.
Nobody but Jesus did it suddenly.
Suddenly.
Oh, he did it, yeah.
And he did it.
Oh, he did it, yeah.
Suddenly.
He did it.
And he did it.
Suddenly.
Suddenly.
He did it suddenly. And he did it suddenly. And he did it suddenly.
And he did it suddenly. And he did it suddenly. And he did it suddenly.
Father in heaven, we love you. We thank you so much. You're so awesome, so worthy to be praised. You are the great I am. We thank you so much for your love, your spirit, your redemptive power. We thank you for just being you. We thank you for just knowing all things, knowing where we are and what we need. Even when we refuse to say, even when we can't figure out the words, you already know. Help us today. Bless us today. Heal us today, God. As you have given this word through the ages, as I've been taught the principles found in this passage, help us to hear it, to receive it, to live it, and heal us where we've been hurt and broken so that we might be able soldiers for you. We glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, tell somebody it's compassionate ministry on purpose. Thank you for that, Pam. Thank you for that suddenly. Amen. I hope some of you received your suddenly a couple of weeks ago. Amen. And we know that you were blessed over the last week or so, Wednesday, Elder Ron and Sunday, Elder Moss, and then the debut preaching of Minister Veronica. Amen. And so we are thankful. Amen. Around here, your trial sermon is just your first sermon. You just out there. You just get a date, and even though you say, please, no, I ain't ready, I just say, I'll see you then. Amen. And so we are thankful for her allowing God to use her. Over the past years, just a brief introduction. Something weird happened in the airport. I was there very early yesterday. Just wanted to kind of spend some time thinking and just kind of absorbing what had taken place over the last week or so. And one of the things that we had talked about in the meeting was being fired but still on the job. How many people, preachers, pastors around this country, God has already told them to shut it down, but they continue to pastor, they continue to preach, they continue to do what they do, but void of an anointing, void of the presence of God with them. And so, as some of the ministers know, it is kind of my custom to say, Lord, am I still employed? Am I still doing what you want me to do? Is it time to stop? And so, you know, every now and then, you know, God will say, shut up. But oftentimes he sends you just a small message. And so I've got this lady. I meant to bring the envelope down. Her last name, I believe, her name is Barbara Bowman. And so she was walking into the airport. I was sitting there minding my business. And she came down the escalator, and I kind of caught a view of her. And you could tell she was looking around. And I didn't pay any attention, so I went on back to reading. And then all of a sudden, she made a beeline right at me, ran straight to me, and said, are you a man of God? I said, I hope so. She said, no. Are you a pastor? Now, I'm in my young life stuff. I don't have nothing that says nothing except for bishop, but she can't see that from where she's running to me unless she got 10-10 vision. And I said, yes, ma'am. And she looked, and she said, what church? And I said, well, I'm from Dayton, Ohio. I was here preaching. And she said, oh, you're a bishop. And I said, yes, ma'am. It's on there. And so she said, I don't have a home church. I just started working here at the airport, and I get to go to church every now and then. I have to work every Saturday and Sunday, and I want to pay the man of God my tithe. And so she handed me her tithes and his envelope. I said, well, I'll take it straight to the church. And she says, I know God told me to bring my tithes to you. And it's in this little ViStar, I guess that's a bank, little envelope. And as I was getting on the plane, just walking, tear dropping, and I heard God said, you're still employed. And so I say that to say to somebody who may be going through something and you're wondering if God still wants to use you. And that you're wondering if God still has a heart for your ministry and if God's anointing is still on your life. It's been up, it's been down, it's been good, it's been bad, it's been their fault, it's been your fault. But you want to know, does God still want to use you in this season? If you're here today or you're watching on TV, I'm going to have to believe that God is speaking directly to you right now and saying, yes, I still want to use you. So if that's you and you were wondering, I'd get up and give God some praise right now. I wouldn't even worry about who's around me. If I wanted to know, does God still want to use me? Is his anointing still on my life? And you've gone through some days where you wondered, I'd give God some praise right now for that, for yourself, in public. And so I wanted to share that. It was a blessing to me. And then to top it off, this white family was drinking water and eating, and it was time for them to get on the plane. And they were running over to the trash can. The gentleman, he looked at what was in his hand. He looked at what was in his hand, and he ran over to me, and he handed me two bottles of water, tap still on them. He said, I just want to give you some water. And so immediately I grabbed the water. I said, what does it mean? He said, one is for pastoring, one is for prophesying. And he said, the man brought the prophet a glass of water. And so I'm telling you that I believe we're in a season where God is doing some confirming, God is doing some affirming, and I pray for that man and his family to be utterly blessed. And before I could even stop, God said, I'm going to take care of them. Because they brought the prophet some water. So I was just thankful. I was just thankful how God kept that entire week for me. And I just felt like the Lord this morning wanted me to just come and say to somebody, God's getting ready to use you mightily. God's getting ready to do something with you in a big way. And all you've got to do is be open to God. Amen? Amen. And so we are thankful for that. I can't say it how dynamic, in the dynamic way that it happened. There's no way to say it. But it was just mind-blowing. I never sit down at the Jacksonville airport. If I have ever sat down, it's never been where I sat. No one has ever spoken to me. No one has ever walked up to me. And I'm never there that early at the airport. I'm there at the last minute every single time. And I chose this time by the unction of the Holy Spirit to be there. And I just believe that when we just begin to hear God speak and we obey, not even understanding why we're doing it, God will do some great stuff for us. And in that moment, I needed confirmation of some things, and so God did it. Amen. So I'm thankful for that. So just kind of picking up again from a couple of weeks ago, talking about this parallelism with Nehemiah and the church and this remedy that God has given us for spiritual and physical, financial, emotional, mental, and even the geographical attacks of the enemy. Because we are the elect and the chosen of God, because God has his hand on us, there are going to be certain things we need to expect. Look at your neighbor and say, expect it, expect it. You don't think because God's hand is on you and you repeat to each other that the ubiquitous hand of God is on your life, that you're going to be unscathed by the attacks of the enemy. Now, mind you, I didn't say the enemies was going to defeat you. I said he was going to attack you. Amen. There is going to be an attack. It doesn't matter what you believe and what somebody told you. You can't faith away the attacks that the enemy will bring. And the greater of the anointing, the greater the attack. Amen. There was a guy, he was pretty good. His name was Michael Jordan, and people had trouble checking him. And eventually somebody said, we got to come up with some Jordan rules. We're not going to check him with one person. We're going to surround him with everybody. And how many of you know that you're so anointed that the enemy is not bringing one devil after you no more? That he's bringing legions of devils after you, after your family, after your children, after your money, after your mind, after your body, because there is a mandate on your life for God to use you in a big way. But if you're in the will of God, if you're trusting God, if you're believing God, you're going to come out of that thing like pure gold. Every attack of the enemy is not going to draw things away from you. It's going to help you go higher. Amen. The enemy is going to become your footstool. So the more enemies that you have to defeat, the higher you go in God. Amen. I know we don't like to deal with a whole lot of junk and a whole lot of people, but if you ain't got but one enemy, you ain't got but one step. And I'm telling you that some of you got some places that God is taking you. It's going to take you 10 or 15 steps a month, so you might look for 10 or 15 enemies, 10 or 15 haters, 10 or 15 people that will try to affirm that God is not with you. But look at your neighbor and say, oh, I know he's with me. I know he's with me. I know he's with me. So I'm believing that. And the enemy comes not just to attack, but he comes to distract and try to detour you from the things that God wants you to do. He tries to just get your life over indebted with stuff and overwhelmed with things. And you just overcompensating, trying to help this and do that and run here and run there. But it keeps you off of focus with God. And so God is saying, I'm coming and I'm going to help you in this year. This is going to be the year. Somebody shout, greater grace, greater grace. And so as we investigated Nehemiah in Nehemiah chapter 4, we realized that these five questions, we've been dealing with question 2 for a while. And question 2 simply says, will they fortify themselves? And so when we talked about that, this word fortify again just very quickly means to add ingredients. So we go to 2 Peter chapter 1, and verse 5 said like this, and beside this, giving all diligence,
add to your faith. Now, this word diligence here means that I am going to do something in response to a covenant expectation. See, the Bible teaches us that faith without works is dead. After you pray, you got to get up and do something. You got to move. You got to be guided by the Holy Spirit to make an action. Everything about faith causes an action. So when he talks about giving all diligence, he's talking about doing something in response to my covenant expectation. Well, part of the problem is we don't know what our covenant is. That's one reason we come to church and come to Bible study, because I can't expect what I don't know I got coming. And so now, once I find out, though, now I've got an expectation of it. But because there's an expectation, God asks then certain things of you so that the expectation and the obedience can collide together and you'll receive the promises of God. Somebody say amen. And so there were seven ingredients, and these seven ingredients are needed as evidence and for you to be perfected in order for you to advance in the year of the revelation of Jesus, the year that we've called the year of greater grace. So in verses 5 through 7, he gave us seven principles, and we're on number 6 now. He said, add to your faith, number 1, virtue. Number 2, knowledge. Number 3, I'm going to go back. Say number 1, say virtue. Yeah, number 2, say knowledge. Number 3, say temperance. Number 4, say patience. Number 5, say godliness. I don't want you to go to sleep before I get to the punchline. And then 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 7 says, and to godliness, brotherly kindness. Somebody say brotherly kindness. It's a word that literally means a love for others, especially the brethren. It's the word, we get the word Philadelphia from this word, Philadelphion. And it means the love as a brother. It also means having fondness of mankind. In other words, being benevolent. It's where we get the word philanthropy. And it also means to love towards man or mankind. Say brotherly kindness. It's where our nature is unified and wired to live with great concern for those that we are connected to, first by the human race, then by a common source, and then by our proximity. So this is brotherly kindness. It's Philadelphion. It's love as a brother. It's love towards mankind. It's the fondness and the benevolence that we'll give toward mankind. Psalm 133, the prophet simply said, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment poured on the head that ran down on the beard, even the beard of Aaron, the first high priest, that came down upon the collar and skirts of the garments, consecrating the whole body. It is like the dew of lofty Mount Hermon and the dew that comes on the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, even life forevermore upon the high and the lowly. It's where God sanctifies, or he sanctions the release of the blessing that he's commanding. It's where the collection and the synergy of all the anointing comes together. It's the place where there's no strife and there's no envy, no confusion, no evil, no contention, no discord. It's a place of dwelling together in unity. Somebody say brotherhood, brotherhood. He says how pleasant, in other words, how sweet, how enjoyable, how satisfying, how favorable, and how prosperous it is when people can come together under a common cause to see what it is that God wants to bless the body with. In Proverbs 18:24, it says, a man who has friends must himself be friendly, but there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Now, this particular scripture also leans another way, and sometimes it says some people are too friendly to too many people. Yeah, he was just trying to talk about discernment and understanding that you can't be friends with the world. Amen. But you can be friendly. And so God is teaching us to be friendly. So compassion. It's how we extract from these texts the word that God is looking for. Common passion, compassion. It's because we understand struggle. We understand what people go through. We understand what people need. Our ministry needs to be a ministry of compassion. We know that God has been good to us. Amen. How many of you can testify that God has been good to you? I know you're sitting in here like you wish you were somewhere else, but the football season is over, and y'all don't watch baseball, so you're going to have to hold on with me because the playoffs haven't started yet. But we understand that God has been good to us. And if we just be real honest, we understand the whole deal of God's goodness and what we don't deserve. But I mean, I'm talking about reaching Ray down inside. You know you done acted a fool sometimes, and God shouldn't even be doing for you what he's doing at all. It shouldn't even be on his register to bless you. And if he didn't bless you, watch this, you couldn't even be mad at God. You couldn't even be mad at him if he didn't do nothing special, because you know you haven't been what you're supposed to be. But it's because of the goodness of God that man turns and repents. And it's because of the goodness of God that we say, I want to do better. So we know where we've come from. We know what we've struggled with. We know where God has brought us. And to be quite honest, we know where we're not yet. Amen. Everybody in the pews don't know where you're not yet, but you know. Look at your neighbor and say, you know. You know that you're not there yet. They think you blessed and anointed and highly favored and holy and just a blessing and a prophetic and apostolic, and they done threw all these titles on you. You, God, you the evangelist of the year. You, girl, you just, I just wish I knew the word like you. I wish I studied like you. I wish I prayed like you. I know you pray all the time. I know you study all the time. Look at your neighbor and say, whoo, Lord. Because God shields you. God doesn't allow people to see what you're not and what you're not doing. But some kind of way the anointing flows through you. God uses you anyway, and he blesses other people. So you know that God's been way better than you to you than you deserve. But I believe there's a shift that's coming in the house of God. I believe there's a shift that's taking place amongst the people of God, because I believe now that God is calling us to begin to bear the infirmities of the weak. I believe that God is calling us to a place where we begin to strive together for the glory of God. Amen. Where God is beginning to extend his comfort. Where God is calling us to celebrate one another. Where God is calling us to be like-minded. Somebody say like-minded. Where God is calling us to be like-minded. Acts chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. We talked about it last week. It won't be on the screen, but I just want to mention it. The Bible says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord and in one place, and suddenly. Amen. And so we sung that song today, which really blessed me, about the suddenly. But we also knew that we prophesied last week that some suddenly was getting ready to take place in some people's lives. Amen. And I got some testimony of some suddenly. But watch this. Sometimes suddenly don't just mean it's going to be a blessing. Sometimes suddenly mean the devil getting ready to do something too. And you got to adjust and find out what it is God's trying to say to you in a situation, because the enemy's trying to get in front of what God's getting ready to do. The enemy hears somebody prophesy and he begins to move. The enemy hears somebody give shout and he begins to go into operation. Why? Because he wants to diffuse whatever God's getting ready to do. And so, and suddenly, that's why the Bible says, be sober, be vigilant. We got to be on the lookout. We got to be on the watch, because wherever God is coming to, the devil's going to try to beat him to the punch. He's an imitator. Say imitator. He's a falseness of the move of God. He does the exact opposite. And so we know the end suddenly was coming. So for them, the end suddenly was that everybody that was in this particular room at this particular time, the power of God to accomplish whatever it was that God wanted to accomplish through their lives, the Bible said it sat upon each of them. Why? Because they were in one accord. They were brothers. Somebody say brothers. And so in the sense of brotherhood, it was brothers and sisters. It was people who loved God together. So here's how this term begins to develop: brotherly kindness. And when we read this next set of scriptures, we're going to find out that brotherly kindness also has to do with a word that Jesus uses, and it's the word neighbor. Look at your person next to you and say, hey, neighbor. Hey, neighbor. Hey, neighbor. Hey, neighbor. And and when you've got the right typing anointing on your life, you can ask that question that was asked for years on channel 14 and 16. Wouldn't you like to be my neighbor? And so that's an anointing on that. I think I preached that years ago. Wouldn't you like to be my neighbor? So but we see here some principles that I think are going to be important for us in this next move of God, because Peter was prompted by the Holy Spirit to say, if you're going to see the advancement of the kingdom of God in your life, and you're going to be a part of this advancement, you got to add to your faith. You can't just walk around here talking about I believe. There's going to have to be some evidence that you're willing to be a part of the move of God. And so he said, add to your faith virtue, add to the virtue knowledge, add to the knowledge temperance. And he went on and on until he got to number six. He said, and then to godliness, I want you to add brotherly kindness. Now, it was awful strange that after all those powerful things, we see that six and seven are really conditions of the heart, where it talks about brotherly kindness. And then number seven, you'll see, is love. Charity is what's used in the King James Version. But brotherly kindness just kind of pops out of nowhere right there in the middle of that text. Doesn't necessarily seem like it would fit because it all looked like how I was dealing with myself or dealing with God and allowing God to show himself through me. And then all of a sudden, I come to this place where it's about my extension of the love of God to someone else. And you got to remember that Jesus is speaking to people who sometimes know the law. When you read Luke chapter 10, starting with verse 25, I'm not going to go there, but it says a certain expert of the law. And so this particular individual, Jesus talking to those who knew the law, he would always refer to things that they were familiar with. And so when he began to talk about the neighbor, this conversation went crazy. And there was an explanation that came out of it that Jesus uses. And I like Jesus. Jesus, if I hope I don't get struck down, but he like the Holy Ghost Michael Corleone. You know, he just handles stuff like it ain't, you know. And it just shoots you down. It just knocks out every intention that you have. Because the Bible says that they began to ask him questions because they was trying to trip him up. Isn't it funny when people find out that you saved for real? That all they want to do is look for things to trip you up. You know, they always come with that, if you be the man of God, or if you a woman of God, or if you say, they always want to trip you up. But see, here's what you got to understand. They did it to Jesus. They're going to do it to you. Our problem is we don't know how to answer them. Our problem, we get all offended and start sweating, and then they know that you ain't all that you said you was. All you got to look at your neighbor and say, calm down, and give them the word. All right, that's what Jesus does. That's why when even the enemy tempted him when he was in the wilderness and he was up on the mountain and the enemy tried to come, he just kept saying, it is written. He didn't try to come up with nothing new. He went back to what his daddy said. So this brotherly kindness and this neighbor thing, it means something in the midst of us advancing the kingdom. Luke chapter 10, verse 30, in the New King James says it like this. When after they had asked and tried to tempt him, it said, then Jesus answered and said, he's explaining a situation. Everybody say parable. But Jesus uses parables to talk about a situation. But he also uses, in these parables, they're real. It's something that Jesus saw that somebody else didn't see. And oftentimes, they're called emotional word pictures. They're opportunities for someone based on their knowledge of the geography and the times. It's their ability to understand what he's saying or get the message. Somebody say, get the message later. Have you ever been sitting in church and somebody said something and you didn't know what the ham fat they were talking about, and then all of a sudden you was riding home, or you were in the tub, or you were eating, and that thing hit you like a light? You say, oh my God, I got it now. Lord, have mercy. That's what the parable was. God spoke into these people's lives so it would get into their heart. May not understand it now. Somebody say, but eventually, the light's going to click on for you. So Jesus said in his answer to these men that were expert of the law, and they even tried to contest with him, and we'll get there in a minute. Don't want to get ahead of myself, but this was his answer. He said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, who stripped him of his clothing, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And so this text, as you will see, teaches us a lesson on just who is our neighbor. Because when the man asked about the inheriting eternal life and the word neighbor came up, he began to try to act like he didn't know what Jesus was talking about. And so when your neighbor, when we're talking about neighbor, we're not just talking about the person that lives next door to you. The Bible teaches us that we are commanded to love our neighbors as ourselves. So the man who's being addressed in this text needed this lesson, like many of us need this lesson today. It's quiet, and it's probably better, because this ain't a shouting lesson. See, the question was asked of Jesus early in the text, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus asked him what the law said, and here was the young man's answer. You know, Jesus was smooth. What must I do? to inherit eternal life. Inherit, and you can imagine these pharisaical folk turning their back and looking toward the crowd like they got Jesus in a quandary, like he don't know what to say, because they're trying to get Jesus to say, believe in me, too early. How many of you know you don't need to reveal yourself real early? You quit walking around putting a title on your name. When they ask you your name, don't talk about I'm minister so-and-so. Just be who you are, because the enemy's trying to get you to reveal yourself too early. That's why a lot of times when Jesus performed a miracle, he said, don't even tell them who I am. I don't want them to frustrate the plan of God. I'm not going to get it. Look at your neighbor and say, don't get ahead of yourself. Don't get ahead of yourself. God's got something he's planning. So they were trying to get him to say something so they could crucify him too early. But Jesus understood the times. He couldn't die until it was Passover time. Some of y'all want to be known too soon. You don't need to be known until you die. You don't need to be known until that old man is killed. You don't need to be known until you done got rid of some of your stuff. You want to be known too early, and now that you have made yourself a parent, now they can trip you up. I took a hit from becoming bishop too soon. It was going to happen, but I let somebody convince me it ought to happen way back here. I wasn't through growing through some stuff yet. Oh, y'all didn't catch that R in there, did you? I didn't say going. I said growing through some stuff yet. I still had a lot of mistakes to make. I still had a lot of stuff to learn. And if I would have waited, it would have been a lot easier to be who I am now. But it's all right, because as long as you stick in there, God's going to make you who you're supposed to be. But he tried to trip him up. How do you inherit eternal life? And so he was waiting on this answer so he could run and tell all the people, the rulers of the synagogue, to come get Jesus now. And so Jesus flipped it. Look at your neighbor and say, he flipped the script. He flipped the script. Jesus looked over and said, what the law say? You the expert. You the one know the book backwards and forward. That's why some of y'all need to quit arguing with these knuckleheads on Facebook. I done told a few of my ministers, get off of there. Leave them to flip alone. Just ask them, what does the Bible say? And be done with it. Jesus said, well, you tell me. So the young boy answered like this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. Now, I do want to stop right here and say this to some of you. Some of you need to learn how to love God with your mind. You're not intellectually astute on who God is, and you need to become that. He need to be bigger than the man upstairs. He's more than just a Savior. Sometimes we need to sit down and learn so that we can have a greater acquaintance with the person we worship. Oh, you love him in your heart, but you need to learn how to love him in your mind. Especially my millennials, you need to be able to go to college. You need to be able to deal on your job with philosophies and worldviews and mindsets and stuff and even science, where you've got an answer for every man, the Bible says. Telling somebody, well, it don't take all that. I don't need to know all that. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Because somebody's going to come across your path, and you're going to have to explain to them Jesus in the terms that they can understand it. I don't need to know science more than I need to know Jesus, but I need to know Jesus more than they know science. But he said, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Look at your neighbor and say, he hit it on the head. He hit it on the head. The brother was good. So Jesus said, you have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. See, when part of the problem was, between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, there was some argument about eternal life, because see, the Pharisees believed that you had to fulfill the whole law, and the Sadducees didn't even believe in resurrection. And so there was a confusion about how we're going to get this eternal life. What does this mean? Does this mean we'll never die? Does this mean we'll die and come back? Now we even get confusion now where they start teaching reincarnation. I ain't coming back as no dog. I done been called a dog before, but I ain't going to never have a tail and bark, that's for sure. You ain't coming back as another entity. You ain't been here before. It's quiet because some of y'all believe that. Some of y'all don't believe that. Facebook and karma done got y'all jacked up. You're trying to think of who you was in the last life. You was a bump in your mama's stomach, then you was born, you gonna die, and look at your neighbor and say, that's it. You ain't coming back, Joan of Arc 12. When this life is over, we fly away. And the new heaven and new earth comes from heaven, and it rests down on the new earth, and that's it. You are a spirit being. Your soul is eternal, and you die. The spirit goes back to the Father. Your flesh goes back to the ground. The soul is at rest until God calls you home. And when that time comes, the Bible says you should not be without comfort, that because in the last days, when the trump of God and the voice of the archangel comes, there will be a catching away, and the dead in Christ shall raise first. And all that remains shall be caught away to forever be with the Lord. You ain't coming back as nothing else. Al Green was right. Jesus is coming back. But when we leave, we ain't coming back. Tell your neighbor, ain't no coming back. This crazy theology. You was here before. Before what? If you get to come back, we don't need Jesus. If you get to leave and get the answers and come back, I'm going to shoot you now and tell you I'll see you when you get back. Make sure you tell me who you are when you get here. Baxter. The devil is a liar. Ain't no coming back. Our theology is jacked up because we don't understand simple science. So he said, you know what, son? You've answered this correctly. Do this and you will live. Now remember, the Bible called this man an expert. He knew the word. He knew the law. Watch this. He just didn't know how to apply it. Uh-oh. That's us. That's us's. To know it and to do it is two different things. So watch James chapter 4, verse 17. Let me throw this in there. Remember, it is sin. That's why we got to be quick to repent. It is sin to know what you ought to do. Let me sound like Creflo for one moment. Even in giving. God tells you to do something, but you don't want to do it because you had something else you was going to do with it. You walking around living in sin and don't even know it. You'll mess around and war your blessing into the sanctuary. Everybody just do like this, like, I don't want none of this to be my seed. I don't want none of this to be my seed. Just Lord Jesus, get it off of me. Get it off of me. You're a walking seed. Luke 10:29. Watch this. Watch how we do with Jesus. Now it's back to the expert in the law. Jesus said, you did good. Now live it out. Watch what he said. But he wanting to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Watch. Looking for a loophole, he asked, and just how would you define neighbor? Don't that sound like us? I mean, when you say love what you really mean. Sometimes my teeth tie and I talk about forgiveness and people say, can I ask a question? Sure. Well, when you say forgive, and I be thinking to myself, rich young ruler, expert in the law, everybody say forgive is to forgive. It means to forget it happened and to give that person the same chance as they had the first time. I know some of y'all like, come on, bitch. You don't know what they've done to me. You don't know what they said about me. And you talking about forgive them and pray for them and ask God to bless them and to increase them and to cause them to receive the promises of God after the way they done treated me and dogged me and did me and made a public nuisance out of me. And you asking me to just lay that down like did nothing happen? Look at your neighbor and say, surprise, surprise, surprise. Yeah, yeah, yeah. God is saying that whatever I ask you to do, just do it. But we struggle with that because we try to find the loophole. That's why our blessings keep coming in patches, because our blessings fall in the loopholes. You're living in loophole manifestation. Instead of it being a flow, it keeps dropping off just when it was getting ready to be at its best place, and all you get is the dribblets that don't fall down. Because we keep trying to justify. I mean, holy in it's the Holy Ghost, boy. He holds your mouth. It's the Holy Ghost. So shut up, son. So he said he looked for a loophole. In other words, he was saying, I don't really know what you mean by neighbor. Do I have to know their name and their cell number? Do I need to know where they live? Do I need to know their last name? Who is it that is really considered my neighbor? Because if we're not careful, our neighbor is the person we've chosen to be kind to. That's going to be my neighbor. I'm going to pick and choose who God wants me to be precious to, who I'm going to be a blessing to. You see a person with a need, but you won't bless them. You'll wait till somebody you know might need it, and you'll give it to them. And I'd be doggone if God asked me to bless somebody that I know don't like me. You ever thought that you ain't real likable? And the people who do like you, they're overlooking some stuff about you because they know more about you, that you got some good side to you, but the other person don't know your good side yet. Come on, you ain't never acted a fool in front of somebody for the first time. This your first encounter with them. You acted a fool, and now you mad because they don't really like you. I remember going up to the barbershop one day. I used to just walk up there. It wasn't getting no cut. Just walk up there to see my buddy. This guy walked in. They said, oh, what's up, Bishop? So the guy said, you from down the street? Oh, so you that dude from down the street? Man, I heard about you. So the next time I go up there, he getting his hair cut. I speak to everybody. He said, oh, you ain't going to speak? Did you remember what you said to me the last time? We ain't gonna have this conversation again. Oh, so you just speak to them. I repented, but in my flesh, I was wanting to say, yeah. Why I want to speak to you? You getting ready to try to dog me in public. Loophole. The text teaches us not only how to love a neighbor, watch this, but how we should get along with one another. We need to find out who our neighbor is before you go out looking for it. But before you go out looking for it, you need to know how to treat people right up in here. See, because we run to this altar for healing. We run to the altar for prosperity. We run to the altar for deliverance. We run to the altar when we got to get that lust spirit off, that homosexual spirit off, that addiction spirit off, that drunk spirit off, that lying spirit off. We run to this altar, but we don't flock to the altar when we say, who wants to love better? Who wants the Spirit of God increased in you so you can love your neighbor? It's a slow move to the altar. But here go the problem. Until this becomes an atmosphere of love, you can throw the healing and prosperity stuff right on out the window. Until the altar is flowing with the love of God, don't think you get to walk away with the goods and you don't have the heart. When you come to the house of God, you don't come to get blessed. Let me help you. You come to get broken. He broke it, then he blessed it. You get blessed in your brokenness. Because if you ain't broken, you'll leave out of here in trouble, because persecution come with the blessings. But I'm able to deal with the persecution once I've been broken. Look at your neighbor and say, I need to be broken. I need to be broken. And listen, and God ain't trying to break you to harm you. He's trying to break you to bless you. Y'all hold on. He's trying to break you to bless you. He's trying to break you to help you. He's trying to get more of you out of you and more of him through you. Somebody say the right atmosphere. All right. I know I ain't jumping and shouting. 1 John 4:20-21 in New Living. If someone says, I love God, but hates a Christian brother or sister. And that word hates, in this New Living Translation, when you go to a concordance that helps you with the New Living Translation that's extracted from the King James, this word not only means hates, but it also means to hate to see. You got to check yourself when you see another saint and you roll your eyes. You got to check yourself when you see another saint and your lips perk up and you ain't about to kiss. When you dodge a hug. I mean, I ain't talking about nobody here, but I'm just saying something that you can share to your friends that go to other churches. When you get home, you can share it with them and just say, hey, y'all can't be dodging hugs and you can't be dodging saying hi to somebody. If you ever done fake like you was talking on the phone so you ain't got to speak to somebody, you need to repent. Sometimes we done start talking to people that we barely like to not talk to people that we really don't like just so that we don't have to speak to them. I'm not talking about Potter's House people, but I'm saying people in the world that don't know God the way they say they know God. And I know some of y'all ain't on this and you're like, oh, he on this. I thought he was going to be saying something else. That's your problem. That's why you ain't growing in God, because you done missed the first principle. He told the church at Laodicea, listen, I got all your stuff. I know what you're doing, but you done lost your first love. You done missed the whole boat. You think you saved and what you walking in. It says, if you say, I love God, but I hate to see a Christian brother or sister, the Bible says, not Mark McGuire, not the bishop, not the pastor, not the preacher, the Bible says that person is a liar. For if we don't love people we can see, how can we love God whom we cannot see? Watch this. And he has given us this command. Those who love God, everybody say must. Also, somebody say also. Those two words, there's no option or no other consideration except for that it's absolutely necessary. love their Christian brothers and sisters. And watch this. And we got to learn how, when we don't get love, to shut up and just love back and don't even complain about it. Because the moment you open your mouth about it, you just disqualified your love. Because real love don't judge non-love. It just loves. So let's walk a little farther in the text real quick before y'all go all the way to sleep. And see who God says our neighbor really is. Have you noticed that in church, the things that divide us, they're always the little bitty things? Rich, poor, white, black. You say tomato. I say tomato. We got all these little bitty things. Baptist, Pentecostal. If it's a choir or a praise team. If they greeters or ushers. As long as they ain't an usher, I don't care what you call them. I just don't want no ushers in here. If they light skin or dark skin, you know, just that's the kind of stuff that, you know, we fight about in places where we're supposed to be worshiping. And now, with the political climate the way it is, if it's Republican or Democrat, you know, you got some folk in some places, and I don't hope they ain't in the house of God, but you got some folks in some places that ain't friends no more because they find out that you're Democrat or you Republican. The first thing you got to do, I know we're getting ready to do some election around here for the primary, so let me just help you real quick and get this out. You're going to have to learn how to vote your convictions. I don't care who you registered with. That don't make a difference. Because really, we ain't got a whole lot of good choices this time anyway. Trump too slick. Hillary too liberal. Bernie just too old. Rubio too timid. And Cruz don't know half the time. So you're going to have to learn on your convictions. You're going to have to learn about what you believe in, what you believe the Bible says, and who's supporting that. That's who you want in office, because the Bible says when the righteous are in rule, then the people will rejoice. So we don't need to be divided on that. But here's one thing I do know. God is not up for re-election. That's one thing I do know. We ain't got to worry about if he's going to be God next year. So for the next 4 years, I don't give a flip if it's Donald, Hillary, Bernie. It don't make me a difference who it is, because at the end of the day, God is the leader of everybody. And my Christian brother reminded us last week that he is still in control. Somebody say God. God. We worried about it, panic, and about to lose our minds. God is in control. The election ain't bigger than God. You ought to vote to get what's done in the natural, but God ain't going to let his people go down without God bringing them back up. He's not going to allow us to be jacked up and flipped upside down as long as we trust him. I don't know if Barack Obama did a good job or not the last 8 years, but when I look at my last 8 years, God did a good job. My ruler did an excellent job. My president did a good job. My leader has been God for a long time. Yes, sir. Revelation 4, 1 and 2 in the Amplified said, after this I looked and behold a door standing open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard addressing me like the calling of a war trumpet said, come up here and I will show you what must take place in the future. And at once I came under the Holy Spirit's power, and behold a throne stood in heaven. Watch this. With one seated on the throne. Isn't that good news? Yeah, look at your neighbor and say, ain't but one on the throne. Ain't but one. So we get back to these merciful manners as we get back to this compassionate ministry. The Bible's just telling us we're supposed to get along with folk, and we can't have these little small issues. But we do have some responsibility, or some sense of responsibility. Watch this. Not only for them, but to them. Genesis 4 and 9. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? Well, the truth is, we are our brother's keeper. Now, be mindful, everybody can't do everything for everybody. And so if you wanted a person that didn't get everybody to do something for you, then you just got to just believe that God ain't forgot about you. And if you're one of those persons that's running around trying to do everything for everybody, you're going to wear yourself out. You're going to have to be led by God, who you're supposed to help. But once God tells you, you can't start trying to justify that you ain't supposed to help them. When others are going through, watch this, you can't act like you don't have nothing to do with it. If nothing else, we better learn how to pray for one another. Remember what the scripture said, how can you say you love God who you don't see? My father teaches us from the scriptures that need pulls on random acts of kindness. Need pulls on the random acts of kindness. There's going to be things that God is going to require you to do as a random act of kindness because somebody else has a need. 1 John 3:17 says, but if anyone has enough money to live well and sees a brother or sister in need and refuses to help, watch this, how can God's love be in that person? That's the scripture. That don't have nothing to do with somebody's interpretation. That's just what it says. The world is going to know that you're his disciples when you've got love for your brother. No demonstration of love disqualifies you as being recognizable as a child of God. Everybody say demonstrative love. Demonstrative love. Somebody say demonstrative love. That means love in action. If this can't come through you, you just disqualified yourself. So what is it that's in us that makes us so homogenous to where we can only hang with people that act just like us? If you don't praise like me, I can't kick it with you. If you don't think like exactly the way I think, you can't kick it with me. If your hair ain't done the way we like our hair done, you can't be with us. What makes us like that? Insecurity, that's what makes us like that. So for so many of us that call ourselves saints, our neighbors are just the people who physically live around us. But your neighbor may be somebody that walks up to your little gated community and they walk up on foot and you got to see what they need. It may be somebody that don't have a roof over their head. It could be somebody that sits in your same row. And the only thing they've ever said to you was, excuse me. But in our text, Jesus calls this man a certain man. Somebody say a certain man. We know he is of Jewish descent because of the path that he took. Look at this. Luke chapter 10, verse 30 in the King James. And we're getting ready to go. Watch this. We're going to be done. A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He went down, say down. Now this is just like going into the neighborhood, going into the hood. Going from Jerusalem to Jericho is like coming down Far Hills, making a left on Stewart and coming over the bridge. Let me help y'all. He kicks it in Oakwood normally, but he decided today he gonna come over the bridge. We don't know why he's coming over the bridge. We don't know what his intention was, but the Bible says he went from Jerusalem down to Jericho. Now watch this. Once he gets in the hood, he gets jumped. Because it's a tough road. It's a dangerous road. Anybody ever been on a tough road in your life? You ever lived a dangerous road in your life? He's on the Jericho road. Some of y'all still on the Jericho road now. Because you got to go from one place to another, and you got to cut through the hood. So in essence, this man, he was either caught walking or he got carjacked, but we know for sure he got stripped and beat down. Well, back then he probably would have had to get horse jacked or mule jacked, but he was stripped and beat down. He's actually physically bleeding, hurt, and left to die by the people who robbed him. The Bible says he's half dead. They took what they wanted and left him. Has anybody ever taken from you innocence, dignity, money, time, trust, energy, best years of your life, and then they leave you half dead? This is a critical scene. He's half dead. He needs help quickly or he's going to die. It's a tough time to be half dead. But watch this. At the same time, he's half alive. Tell somebody, I ain't dead yet. I ain't dead yet. Look at this man's disposition. He survived the beating, but he's not happy. This is what we got to understand sometimes about the house of God. Many of the people that's around you, they survived the beating, but they still ain't happy. You see them half alive, but they feel half dead. That's why we've got to be careful how we treat one another, because you don't know what kind of wounds you're walking up on. They survived, but they still in trouble. Get this picture. The attack is over, but they're still wounded. I see this going another way, Jesus. I see this going another way. The attack is over, but they're still wounded. And here's the thing, and if you don't get help quickly, you might just die from the wounds. Pain, your past, current situation, after effects, your setbacks. Has somebody tried to kill you, rob you of anything, left you wounded, hurt, offended, injured, misunderstood? Anybody ever get a hold of you and almost beat the life out of you with lies, deceit, exposure, insensitivity, watch this, or just bad intentions? I ain't even talking about a physical beating. I'm talking about, has anybody been dealing with emotional beating? Leaves you in a position where you need some oil and some wine. I feel it today, God. This lesson that Jesus is teaching, watch this. God has a way, though, of sending somebody to help you get over the wounds of your enemy. Can I prophesy right here? Yes, God said to me last night, son, tell them these words. Your setback is your setup. It's not what it looks like. It's not what it feels like. And it's not what it seems like. And this help sometimes is just called plain old brotherly kindness. Have you ever been wounded and nobody helps you? Your relationship is in shambles. You're hurting right now, but won't nobody help you? You lose a home, you lose a job, you lose a friend, you get arrested, you catch a case, you get sick, you get busted, you get caught up, you get back in your same old mess, and you're even about to lose your mind right now, and everybody is just passing by. Like the man in the text, you're lying there bleeding and everyone can see your condition, but ain't nobody helping you. As a matter of fact, your condition done hit the headline news at the barbershop, the beauty salon, the club, and the church. Everybody's heard about it. Everybody's called around about it. Everybody might have even stopped by to be nosy to see how bad it is, but don't nobody help you. But let's be fair, because you also can't be the one that's half alive acting like you got it all together either. When you need some help, somebody shout, help! Yeah, when they saw Jesus, they cried out for Jesus. Because sometimes, watch this, the fairness to other people, sometimes people can't see your blood because you laying on your wound. But here's the man in our text. He's lying there, a bloody mess, and he hears some steps. Somebody say, I hear steps. Somebody's coming. But either you got to decide if you're going to shout hallelujah or you're going to shout oh no. Because you don't know who these footsteps are coming from. Sometimes when help does come and you sense footsteps, you don't know whether it's help or if it's the enemy coming back to finish you off. And that's why for some of us, we got to be careful about doing things on the rebound. You gotta be careful just jumping into something else because something else didn't work. You gotta consult with God because what comes your way just might be the devil. Mm-hmm. Some of y'all catch that when you leave. You'll be at home cooking. There'll be one more argument. You'll realize the rebound. You bought something too quick. It's a rebound. But I come to tell you to don't let what happened to you in the past make you too paranoid to get help for your future. Help is on the way. I'm going to prophesy again. God is sending a neighbor to perform a random act of kindness on your behalf. And if you are the person that needs it, you ought to give God some praise. You ain't got to stand up, but you ought to give God some praise. If you know you need a random act of kindness in some area of your life, God just said he's going to send you a neighbor that's going to perform that random act of kindness. So watch this, and then we need to go. He hears the steps, and lo and behold, out the tear and the bloodstained eyes, he sees the priest. The first steps he hears is a priest, a church person. A religious person, somebody he can relate to, one of his own. He begins to think, I'm going to live, I'm going to make it. But the priest, when he saw him, just passed by on the other side. His brother, he's thinking, saw me, but didn't help me. That's the problem with religion. Religious people have no power to help you. Folk that look good on the outside, but still messed up on the inside, can't help you. And the reason they can't help you is because they faking like they got it all together. And that's why it's easy to say religion has no compassion. Even when religion tries to lend a hand, it has no capacity to help you heal. Because most religious people are still bleeding themselves. In church, but no potency. In church, but no victory. In church, but no real bowels of mercy. In church, no peace, no joy. But wait, he heard some more feet. Now, he looks out of the good eye, and he sees a Levite. The Levite is the person in charge of the worship. First the preacher, and now the worship leader. Yes, this worship leader sings and plays for God. I ain't talking about Pam, so don't y'all be looking at Pam. But this is who it was. It was the Levite. This was the one who led in worship. But watch this. He had the censer and the stuff for worship, but he was in a hurry to get to church. Too worried about going to church and not being the church. I'm not saying it's not good to come to church, but I am saying ain't no sense of you keep coming to church if you ain't gonna never be the church. Forgot that salvation came to him to help others to get healing, not just to be satisfied with his own. He looked at the man, and then he too passed by on the other side. Then somebody called a certain Samaritan, someone who the Bible says should have no dealings with this other man, stops and demonstrates love. I heard Bishop say a certain man met a certain Samaritan. God has people appointed that will come to your rescue in your time of need. I hope you're seeing this, because your help may be coming from the person you least likely was going to look for it from. We always try to figure out who's supposed to help us rather than trusting God that God knows who needs to help us. Because if the same person helps you too much, you begin to replace God with them. And God has a way of separating you from the person that you made God. You can't judge a folk's role in your life based on race, creed, color, church affiliation, social status, maturity in Christ, or years in the church. Martin Luther King Jr. said, you can't judge a man by the color of his skin, but by the content of his character. So it's not my color is black or white. My color is love. You've been down and your family's passed you by because there was no character. Brothers and sisters looked at you funny when you were going through. No character. church member, a priest, a preacher, no character, will leave you half dead and act like they never saw you. But this Samaritan had compassion on him. This is the life and the love of Jesus Christ. This is the type of message why I wore this robe and this chain that nobody likes, but everybody needs. The Samaritan cared for the wounded man. He got off his mule, poured in his own oil and wine, stopped the bleeding, put the man on his mule, took him to a place of shelter and recovery, paid for it, and promised to pay for anything that would make any type of bill and be left for the people at the hotel. And here is the key. He didn't even know the man. Real brotherly kindness doesn't need to know your past. Doesn't need to know if you're a tither or not. Doesn't need to ask if you're saved or not. Doesn't need to know if you're living right or not. I don't even need to know if you're the church member. I don't need to know if you've been baptized. I don't need to know if you're a greeter on the praise team or in leadership. All I know is I saw you bleeding, you were wounded and alone, and I had compassion on you. Where are the folk at that are half dead and can get help, and people don't have to ask a bunch of questions about you? I need somebody when I'm down that will make me smile. When I'm hurting, that will make me laugh. When I'm lonely, will stop by and check on me. The priest stopped by, passed by. The Levite passed by. And the Samaritan stopped. It's a lesson of brotherly kindness that simply says, I have no idea who God's getting ready to use to help me. But it also says, I have no idea who God's going to use me to help. So the scripture ends like this. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hand of the robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, you can hit it. Bam. You can hit it. Go and do likewise. All your spiritual prowess, all your abilities in God, all of what you think you know, all become disqualified when you don't have the heart of the Good Samaritan. Brotherly kindness is that boring subject, because oftentimes with brotherly kindness, nobody gets to find out about it. You're not allowed to go brag about it. You're helping people that other folk might not have helped. As a matter of fact, you might be helping Sister So-and-so them that the other folk at the church don't even like. You had to give them a ride in your new car. You had to spend the money you was going to spend on them. And then you're going to have to pick up a bill that they might leave without sending you a note to say thank you. Because the one thing that I noticed in the text is that the man who got help, he never said thank you. He never said, I appreciate it. He never called him back. He never looked him up to see if he could pay him back for the money. And that's the problem with most folk that say they saved. When you help somebody, you always expect something back. Maybe you don't want reciprocation in money, but you want something in return. We didn't do it out of the kindness of our heart. And so we got some stuff that God's going to do. We got some things that we can preach about. I come from a conference. I'm so full. And I knew not to preach what I heard. I knew not to just pour out what came. Because we run away from here stealing gifts that we can't hold if we haven't set the right atmosphere in our lives. You have to be determined to let God use you to help somebody that can't pay you back. So I'm going to pray for two sets of people, because you're in here today. I saw God going another way. Some of you in here are hurting and you're bleeding. And some of you feel like nobody's helped you. And it's been a long time. You've been in church a long time. You've been at this church a long time. You've been in life a long time. And you're hurting from something of your past, current situation, or just it being alone. And somehow you feel like people have been passing you by. And for the longest, you've been scared to admit it because of what you wanted people to think of you. And you didn't want anybody to know that you were hurting like this. If you're hurting for any reason, and you need God to stop by and see you this morning, I'm calling you to the altar. It doesn't matter what your hurt is. It doesn't even matter if it's your fault. It doesn't even matter if it's your sin. It doesn't even matter if somebody did something to you. It doesn't even matter if you've been rejected. It's hurt. And you know that if you don't get over this hurt, God can't have you the way that He wants to have you. You don't have to name it to me. It could be addiction. It could be homosexuality. It could be lust. It could be whatever it is. But you know it's an act, and it's an outpouring of the hurt that's deep down on the inside of you. And you thought the preacher was going to help you. You thought the worship leader was going to help you. But you're looking now for love in all the wrong places. And God is saying He's sending you help from somebody who's just simply a neighbor. It might not be somebody strange. It might be somebody that you know. But it could also very well be somebody that you had no idea would reach out with a hug, would reach out with a smile, would reach out with a word. But the key to this move right now is that I'm tired of hurting. And God, I need your help. Remember when we started earlier, we were in worship and we lifted our hands and we said, "It's me, oh Lord, in the need of prayer." It's the greatest act of humility is to say, "God, help me right now." And here was the key to this story. He was half alive, able to come to church possibly, able to put on a suit or put on a nice dress, able to go get your hair done and your nails done, and able to get the haircut and show up, but dying. The nice clothes and the nice makeup is hiding the wound, and the blood's not gushing out right now, but the bandages are soaked and you can feel them. And when you get home, you're back where you started, and maybe worse, because you went to the house of worship and nobody said anything. Nobody reached out. And I know everybody can see that I'm hurting. And the last thing that I want to happen at this church is that you come here hurting and you leave here hurting and we didn't say anything to you. But in all fairness, some of us are hurting too. And so while you're looking for a smile, I'm looking for a smile. While you need a hug, I need a hug. And we're both waiting on each other to make a move, and neither one of us do it, and we walk away still broken. But I'm telling you today, God's getting ready to hug you. Because at the end of the day, I love everybody in here. I love Elder Ron. Elder Ron's been with me through thick and thin. He's been with me on my ups and downs. He's never judged me openly. He's never said anything negative to me. I've been able to dump on him, joke with him. He's been a confidant to me in this house for years. I've had him since he came. He's been right there with me. I can always hold on to him. It's been nothing he wouldn't do for me. But sometimes he can't help me. Sometimes I got to call on the name of the Lord. And I got to leave it right there. I got to ask God to do this for me right now. I've got a bishop who's probably one of the greatest bishops in the world. He talks to every major ministry, minister, worship leader in the world. They call him on his phone, and he calls and talks to me. So I've got somebody in my life that's phenomenal. But there are moments when he can't help me. I've got to come to God. I've got to get this wound healed in my life. That girl, that man, that thing, it's not going to help me. Matter of fact, it's going to make me worse because I'm trying to use it to fix what ain't getting fixed, and it's really making me worse. So now I'm becoming worse of a person trying to fix my wound. This is when you step into the throne room of God by yourself. This, you don't come in husband and wife right now. You don't come in brothers and sisters right now. You don't come in twins, even Siamese twins right now. You come in by yourself to the throne of grace. Because I need this one for me, God. And then after I pray, listen, the empowerment of your healing is going to be the projection now for you to bless somebody else. Don't you get from God what you need and don't pass it on. Now you've got to be a conduit of that same type of healing, that same type of blessing, that same type of compassion and love. It can't stay in you. It's got to flow out. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, on a Sunday that we call Super Sunday, just first Sunday, we're kind of dressed up in our phylacteries. We're kind of dressed up in our black. We're kind of dressed up in our priestly attire. We're trying to be the church visible on this particular Sunday. But God, in between and underneath all of that, we've got some stuff that hurts. We've got some pains we can't go beyond. It wasn't lights and flashing and running and jumping and shouting today. It's a flat-footed message, a boring message to our natural ears, but a necessary message to our hearts. First, God, we're asking that you heal us. Old wounds that just keep popping open, stitched and bandaged and sutured and everything you can do to it to keep it closed, and somehow it keeps leaking back into our lives, in our minds, our hearts, our attitude, our joy, our peace, contaminates it. Just when we thought we were over it, something happens to break it open again. The skin pops, and here we are bleeding again. So God, we need a healing from the inside out. It doesn't even matter if the old wound shows so that we can have a testimony. We just want it closed up forever. We don't want it to bleed on us or anyone else ever again. So fix it, God, whatever took place, whoever left us half dead, whoever mishandled us, misunderstood us, whoever didn't do or misinterpreted our actions, whoever didn't come and see about us, God, whoever took everything that we had, energy and money and our time and our mind and our bodies, God, and misused it for their own good and then walked away and left us dead. We forgive them, first of all. And now, God, we ask for your healing. Your power, the lies, the deceit, the exposure, the insensitivity, the thing that made us look bad, the stuff they try to hold over our heads even now. We forgive them. But God, we pray for your healing. And then God, as you heal us and you empower us and you strengthen us, give us the right type of heart, a heart of brotherly kindness, that we don't forget what you've done for us. We don't forget how wonderful you've been to us. We don't forget how wonderful you've been for us. And we reach out to grab hold to somebody else. We give them that hug, that smile, that love that you've so freely given us, that we won't forget what it means to be kind to our neighbor. Who is our neighbor? Anyone that you point us to. Anyone that needs what we have. And God, thank you for those that have been a neighbor to someone, who's blessed someone, who's taken care of someone, who's put oil and wine in the wounds and wrapped it up and set them on their own mule and taken them and took care of them. Thank you for that. Cause that to be contagious and spread, God. Every instant act of kindness, random act of kindness, as my dad calls it, give us a heart to do that, that we might fulfill your will, oh God. We love you. Make this atmosphere conducive for every blessing, deliverance and healing and prosperity and all the blessings that can overflow. But first and foremost, it's got to be an atmosphere of brotherly kindness, an atmosphere of love. We love you. We need you. And God, we need each other like never before. There's a need, God, to ask for forgiveness one to another. Let us do it, God, before the sun goes down. If we need to forgive somebody, God, help us to forgive them before we even leave this altar. Give us grace right now to forgive and to love right now, God. By faith, God, we'll even say it We'll say their name, God. We'll whisper it. We'll do something to signify that we believe you're going to give us the grace to walk in it. And God, we give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor as we add to our faith virtue, to our virtue knowledge, to our knowledge temperance. God, to our temperance, we continue to add godliness. And then God, to godliness, we add brotherly kindness. Help us, bless us, keep us. And God, let us not forget patience. And we give your glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God some praise. Come on, give God some praise. Bless him. Bless him. Hug somebody and tell them you love them. Just say, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. Come on, tell somebody God loves you.